Hi, this is Mo from Smart Training 365. In this video, I will be covering the effectiveness of compound versus the BRIG20 exercises for hypertrophy and where they fit in other programs. This will help you identify which exercises to use for your goals and eliminate the guesswork and wasted effort. So compound lifts are movements that involve more than one joint, like the squat, deadlift, bench press, etc. The BRIG20 exercises involve one joint with minimum peripheral recruitment. They are isolation exercises, but different than the traditional isolation exercises because they are designed to comply with the 16 biomechanical factors that determine exercise efficiency. If you don't know what the 16 biomechanical factors are, please watch my previous video. Let's now see what people are saying in general about the pros and cons of isolation and compound movements. Here are some benefits of compound exercises. Compound exercises improve strength through functional real-life movements. Compounds are a form of dynamic flexibility and better than isolation. They are time efficient, improve coordination and mobility. They promote muscle growth. They burn more calories. Now let's talk about the negative of compound exercises. Muscles can be left behind, easier to cheat. Any exercise can be performed incorrectly. If you are looking at targeting and growing a specific muscle, then compound exercises may not be enough, require longer recovery, cause injuries. Now, let's talk about the benefits of isolation exercises. You can focus on good form, which can help prevent pain or injury from occurring, are a terrific way to pack on size and muscle, can help build more definition. Advanced bodybuilders use isolation. Isolation exercises are often prescribed during physical therapy. Cons of isolation exercises: take too much time, low carryover to performance. You don't lose weight with isolation exercises. Life is not an isolation movement. You can't lift heavy weights then if multiple muscle groups were being recruited, therefore building less overall strength. There are points that I agree and disagree with. For example, improve strength through functional real-life movements. It is true that if you're an athlete, you will benefit from exercises like the squat or the parallel bar dips, for example, because they are similar to movements you do in particular sport. But to say those movements help us in real life more than isolation exercises is not accurate. When all skeletal muscles are individually strengthened, a person's total body strength is every bit as useful and functional as it would be if those muscles were strengthened by way of compound exercises. The sum is the total of its parts. Another point, compounds are time efficient. It's true that working each muscle individually will make the session longer than working the same muscle groups with compound exercises, but that's assuming that the same muscles are equally stimulated during both kind of lifts. But we know it's not the case. The sessions might be shorter and you might save time, but achieving your goal will take longer. Compound exercises are always better than isolation exercises. This is false. Compound exercise can be good for certain applications, but they are generally inferior to isolation exercises for muscle development. So before we get into more details whether it's best to use compound or isolation to build muscle, let's understand how muscle growth happens. Muscular hypertrophy refers to an increase in muscle mass. This usually manifests as an increase in muscle size and strength. Typically, muscle hypertrophy occurs as a result of strength training such as weightlifting. To build muscle efficiently, we need to load each muscle efficiently, meaning you need to load the target muscle with exercises that comply with the muscle's strength curve, allow full range of motion, early phase loading, avoid neurological conflicts, avoid unnatural movements, meaning complying with the 16 biomechanical factors I talked about earlier. Many people did build great physiques not using the 16 biomechanical factors. So clearly, a combination of compound exercises, machines, isolation can get us to our destination. But the problem is that it requires using many exercises, working extremely hard, and it's not sustainable. That's why many people get injured.
When you lift weights, the limbs that are lifting that weight are interacting with gravity at a certain angle. And that determines how much load, how much percentage of load that muscle is going to get. And some people, like, they try to poo-poo that and they try to say, oh, it's a Brignoli's trying to reinvent the wheel. No, the wheel is muscle load. The wheel isn't how you get muscle load, the wheel is muscle load. We all agree that more muscle load equals more muscle growth. What people don't understand is that you can get more muscle load using less weight with better physics. What does that mean? It means that you will build your muscles better with less wasted effort, less risk of injury, less wear and tear on your joints. It's not a matter of working as hard as you possibly can. It's a matter of loading that muscle as best you can, as efficiently as you can, with the least amount of wear and tear. It's like the difference between having a wheel that has ball bearings and one that doesn't. It's about wear and tear. It's about friction. It's about trying to get to your goal without being beat up in the process.
It is wise to use an exercise that mimics the anatomical motion of the target muscle rather than an exercise that is designed to move the heaviest weight possible from point A to point B. Let's go back in time and see where do compound movements come from and why people are using them today to build muscle. Physical strength has been revered since the origins of man. According to Greek legend Hercules, who is believed to have been born in the years of 1276 BC, was idolized for his legendary strength. Milo of Creton, a 6th century wrestler, was also credited with many stories of amazing strength, including that he carried a bull on his shoulders for daily exercise. By the 1800s, amazing feats of strength had become a popular form of entertainment, and a number of early strongmen grew their prominence in this pursuit. Arthur Saxon was a strongman and circus entertainer. He became famous for performing one particular lift called the bent press. It's a one-arm overhead lift while bent sideways. Louis Cyr performed a variety of strength acts, including lifting a horse off the ground and holding a platform stack with 18 men on his back. George Hackman Schmidt was a professional wrestler and strongman. In 1899, at the age of 18, he performed a floor press with 361 pounds. In this lift, the barbell is suspended a short distance off the floor by two wooden blocks, providing just enough room for a person to slide underneath the bar. The press is then performed. Obviously, this was the beginning of what would later be known as the bench press. Eugene Sandow is often referred to today as the father of modern bodybuilding because he was one of the first to combine acts of strength with classic poses displaying a muscular physique. In 1920, the sport known as Olympic lifting became recognized as Olympic sport, the clean and jerk and the snatch. These lifts are meant to test an athlete's strength, balance, speed, coordination, and skills. In the 1950s, a sport known as powerlifting was established. In powerlifting competition, the goal is to have the highest sum total of the three distinct lifts: the bench press, the squat, and the deadlift. Early bodybuilding was thus heavily influenced by the preoccupation with power and by the mistaken belief that a well-developed physique required a so-called foundation in the power lifts. But at the root of this misguided belief was a morality-based adulation of strength. There appears to have been a misguided notion that doing exercises that were not intended to demonstrate strength by way of heavy lift was equivalent to an absence of strength, and an absence of demonstrating strength was considered immoral. Can you believe that? If a person elected to do exercises that isolated specific muscles, even though using maximum effort in those lifts, it was equated with neglecting strength development, which is absurd because these two concepts are not mutually exclusive. An individual muscle increases its strength during any resistance exercise, whether that muscle is made to work alone or as a unified effort with other muscles working simultaneously. As you can see, these exercises are not designed based on how our muscle works. They were designed to lift and move heavy weights from point A to point B. Of course, there will be muscle development and strength increases, but it comes with a higher injury risk and wasted effort as compared to using exercises that work each muscle of the body in its ideal environment for the goal of optimal muscle development. These exercises have their place in powerlifting, and sport-specific training would likely require additional strengthening exercises that are unique to the requirement of each individual sport. but that would not negate the value nor reduce the value of any exercise deemed ideal by the 16 biomechanical factor I mentioned earlier for the purpose of functional and visible muscle development. It's worth noting that the 16 principles are true regardless of their age, gender, or their current condition. This is because physics, ideal musculoskeletal motion, muscle physiology, and musculoneurology are universal regardless of the application, notwithstanding individual injuries a person may have previously incurred, which could make even a perfect exercise contraindicated to that individual. I hope this video was useful. I recommend to everyone to try different exercises, different methods, and see what works best for you. That is the best way to decide which exercises to include so you can achieve your goals efficiently and safely. If you didn't watch my video about the 16 biomechanical factors, you can click on the video here. And for workout programs using the BRIG20 exercises, visit us at smarttraining365.com. Thanks for watching.